So what I'm trying to say is we're going into a really, really positive phase for the arts.
Wonderful.
Mm. If people have just the savvy to just, you know, they need to think out of the box.
Yeah.
They can't try and keep things the way it was before. Mm. You know, the world is a stage, so they need to find ways how they can change their concepts. And this is what I've learned, to suit smaller spaces. Well, I'm actually, I had to rush. I'm in my theater, and you're looking at the working lights in the ceiling of the theater.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you probably, it will probably be quite a large chunk of what you're going to ask me, because I can imagine, but I might as well show you. We got a sort of a lounge set up, and we also art gallery. So,
amazing.
I've got a photographer's work that does marine life.
Yeah.
A tiny little stage, and we have about 120 people that come to our shows. Very proud of it. And it was...
Yeah.
Happened because of COVID.
Really?
Yeah. So...
What you say, this happened, all this, because of COVID.
So, Petra, me and my husband, Greg, we have a production company that stages events. So we would travel all over the world to New York. A lot of the work was in Africa, places like Cameroon and Nigeria and Ghana and Uganda and Tanzania. I can ramble off. I don't know if you had a moment to have a look at my profile on Google.
Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I've done a lot of show production work all over the world, including we were talking about India this morning, Delhi. I did Delhi Fashion Week for 2 years. So this all came to a stop when COVID struck. And we have a loft apartment in Johannesburg where we were at the time when the president made the announcement that night. We also happened to have had a holiday house in a small west coast town of Paternoster. Are you familiar with South Africa?
Yeah, I am. I'm from South Africa.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So we decided that night that we were not going to lock down in Johannesburg because we didn't want to be stuck in an apartment in Braamfontein, even though we loved it, but not being able to get out. And it just made sense that for once we could actually go on holiday, because we have never really been able to enjoy the holiday house because we're always working. And we became part of this yearly cycle with repeat business that we just need to go off somewhere. Like every February and every September, we had to be in New York. And then every October, we were doing the Platinum Jewelry Awards, for example, or Mrs. South Africa, some beauty pageant. So, so we were quite busy with that. And then we lost all our work. We came here thinking it would only last about a month, which is what they told us.
Yeah.
And one by one, I just saw all my jobs disappearing. And obviously for two reasons, we couldn't travel. And we went, the nature of our business is to have gatherings. So we got bored, sad, frustrated, angry, and all the above. And just started, you know, when we were allowed to start going out, we would walk around the town and we just came up with this idea that we've got nothing to do. We've always had this fantasy idea of having a small venue in Paternoster where we could produce shows. And so we went to the waterfront management here. And we asked them, do they know of an area that we could possibly rent where that we can turn into a venue? So they were very interested and curious because they also looked up at what we've done and who we are, and they showed us this space, which was fridges for the crayfish.
Wow.
So that's where we got the name. It's called Die Koelkamers. It's Afrikaans for coolers. We kept the sponges on the walls. We just painted over it. There were two koelkamers here. That's why it's cool, more than one koelkamer. And we broke, if you look up, I don't know if I can show you. You see that beam?
Yeah.
All between the two rooms. And they created this space for us. And I asked the community to help us with furniture. And it was honestly a fairy tale. It just came to be, even during COVID. So, at times we couldn't have shows. It was in July last year, they locked us down completely again. We opened in March last year, and it was, we would have 50 people in the audience, but it taught us, it gave us an opportunity to do things properly and to prepare. And we've had possibly about 130 productions or shows already coming since March last year. It's a huge success, and we love it. We absolutely love it. We walk to work on the beach. So I always tell people that COVID was my elegant escape from my previous life, where all we were doing is going, chasing money and going from one show to the other and traveling. And, having to deal with corporate companies and meetings and proposals and everything. And it feels like I'm in heaven, because I pick who I want to show you. And the village and the region just loves it. So we just this last weekend, if you're South African, you probably know who's Levi Axie.
Oh, yes, I know.
we had a Levi Axie production here over the weekend, and we had three sold-out shows on Saturday.
Really?
So it's so beautiful to see all the kids. And it's quite heartwarming, and it's very, very rewarding what we're doing. So on top of that, the work has now started coming back. Our company name when we do productions is Umzingeli Productions, which means hunter-gatherer in Xhosa and Zulu. And it stemmed from when I started doing the Face of Africa model search. I don't know if you came across that when you were reading.
No, I don't. So remember that. Mm-hmm.
For me, that I would say that is, in terms of a career, that's my biggest achievement. So what it was, we started in 1998. Mnet asked me to put together a Pan-African project where they could link all their DSTV subscribers and do one unified event in Africa. And I, because I was in the fashion industry and I've already done the Miss South Africa competition and all sorts of things, I thought that a model search would be appropriate. And we involved Iman, and then we started searching for models across in Africa. And within 3 years, I saw 36 African countries, and then I started working in them. So I'm telling you that because it's kind of what made me. So that stopped in 2010. And since then, we've just been doing show production and all sorts of things. So, and here we are. I'm actually leaving tomorrow to go to Joburg to produce Mrs. South Africa. So we're quite well known in producing pageants. So the work is also coming back. So we have the theater, and then we have shows, events that I do periodically. So that's, in a nutshell, I think I couldn't have explained it better. No, you yeah. need to.
That's what, amazing. But now I've got more things to ask you, because you've just opened up this world that I'm now so inquisitive to know. But first you have to tell me, how did you get into the fashion industry? If you say you worked in the fashion industry, where did you grow up in South Africa?
How much time do you have? I'm a quick rundown. So born in Ketmanshoop, Namibia. Yeah. And during my childhood went spent time in Johannesburg, Pretoria, Durban, Cape Town, Somerset West. I matriculated, and then I went to Stellenbosch University. And from there, I went to the military. You know, we had to be in those years, you had to do your military service.
Yeah.
And I was based in Johannesburg Central. Funny enough, it's like a recurrence. Sad, irritated, bored with my job. You know, we were just pushing around files in Central Joburg. I don't know if you know Joburg. There in the center at Joubert Park, there's a military establishment. So I spent a lot of time there. And I think it was 1983 or 84, I walked past a model agency in Breer Street, just sort of, you know, when you go down there, in my military uniform, everything. And I saw a sign, they were looking for models. So I thought, I'm going to try this. Now, I've got nothing to lose. And they were offering 70 Rand an hour for photographic modeling. And then, so I went upstairs. It was Madge Wallace Models. I don't know if that name rings a bell, but Madge Wallace was probably the first modeling school or agency in the country. And she even worked with designer who came out here to do a collection, and she had to produce the show. We're talking about the 50s, but that's beside the point. I started working with them, and within a year, I got they would ask me to model in fashion shows. So I was quite cocky, and I started telling them how to put the fashion shows together and what music to use, and why don't we rather do the choreography this way and walk that way, or, you know. And Moira Adelaine, who was my boss, said to me, okay, so why don't you do it? So she made me a public relations officer. When I left the military, I joined her permanently. I worked for her about a year, and then I started my own company, and literally producing shows, initially fashion shows and beauty pageants. And I would do them in shopping centers. My first breaking ground was, okay, you can name it. If you know South Africa, I mean, it was Sandton City, Cresta Shopping Center, Southgate, Northgate, wherever. Every weekend I was doing another shopping center show. And that kind of got me to meet the Doreen Morris, who at the time was a presenter on Mnet. I don't know if the name rings a bell for you. And then she bought the Miss South Africa competition in 1994. I mean, what an incredible time. It was, you know, our first democratic elections. And she approached me to run Miss South Africa with her and to change the title so that it would include all races. And that's how I learned to scout for beautiful girls, and then that led to the Face of Africa competition that I did for Mnet.
Amazing.
So that's how I got into the fashion industry. I've got a very I don't believe my talent is fashion at all. I see when I hear music, or I look at a collection, or I look at something, I can instinctively put the right music to it, and I would immediately kind of know how I would present it on a stage. So I became very popular as a show producer for fashion designers. And that's how I got into producing shows at New York Fashion Week. So yep. we would go every February and September to work at New York Fashion Week.
Because this is so interesting that you say that, because this is always the thing in the creative field. So I actually spoke to somebody last week about this, that, you know, the musician has the skill and does the music, but then there's another element that comes to it, and that's the image, and it's the marketing, and it's the how do I present myself. And now that you're talking about this is absolutely the same thing. It's the fashion designer having the designs, having the range that they designed, but then how do I get it out to the public to see it as I intended it to be seen, you know? And you are then this person coming in doing that.
You couldn't have said it better. And it's something that I absolutely love. And then collaborating with someone, not just a designer, but with a client who wants to put on an award ceremony, which we're also very good at, is to do award ceremonies. And then coming up with a concept and a theme for the awards, and then casting the dancers and the presenters and putting it all together. There's a lovely way of putting it that a lady friend of mine, I'm a framer. So,
perfect.
People always, you know, but what is your talent, or what do you actually do? I frame things, live things, you know, so I can pull together anything. You have to be a bit of a multitasker and a jack of all trades. But then you have to be pretty good at all of them too, because part of it is this marketing. We market the theater. I do all the social media, all the marketing, everything for the theater. We do it ourselves. So not just that. And when it comes to show production, just documentation and meetings and presenting things to clients, you need to know how to put those things together. Sometimes it can be, just this morning, I, my production skills during the COVID years has become a bit rusty, and there's, so I had to swap an Excel document to a Word document, and I had to go and look for the templates that we used to, and then my Mac changed it to Pages, and then we couldn't figure out how to remove the highlights that was on the I'm sure you've been through that.
Definitely.
After all these years, you still need to figure that stuff out. It's always changing.
And in marketing as well, and this was also something we talked about with the singer, is this marketing, how it's, you always have to stay on top of it. You know, it's almost as if then there's a new thing coming out, and you need somebody like you to do that, you know, to be there. But now, as a child, did you have this organizational skills? I can just imagine, as a young child in Kitmanshoop, have you organized things or put things together, or where did this love come from?
I'd have to honestly tell you, I don't have a memory, except that I loved school. And I was good at school, relatively good at bookkeeping, and this theater is mostly Afrikaans, and a huge love for Afrikaans as a language. And also, funny enough, that I end up in the fashion industry, where I hardly got a chance to speak Afrikaans, but I have a love for Afrikaans. And I think, which was both sad and I think helped. My parents, they were divorced, and they moved me. They moved around a lot, and they served me well. Mm-hmm. Is that I'm able to adapt so quickly, and I could go to another country or go to another client and quickly grasp what they need, whatever. I mean, just to put it in perspective, from in those years we had sub A. I'm sure, I don't know if you, grade one, grade two, and then standard one through to matric.
Yeah.
In those 12 years, I was in 24 schools.
And
all over the place.
Goodness.
From Durban to Belleville to Pretoria to Otjiwarongo to Windhoek, everywhere. Mm. And I think that has helped me because every year I got a new school uniform, I had to walk into a class, try and make new friends, try and adapt to everything. So I would almost say that prepared me for because my show production work and also in the theater is that I can almost say schizophrenic, because like one day you're dealing with a children's theater, the next day you've got classical music, and every show that we do is so vastly different. So you need to be able to pluck and pull things together quickly. And also just dealing with all the travel and going to places. And so I guess that's what I remember from my youth.
Yeah. So that was that gave you this ability to do that, to put yourself in different situations and to deal with it, you know? This is amazing. Yeah.
It's like a chameleon and quickly learn, you know, when something new faces you. We, in our business, for example, set design. I know nothing about set design, but I had to learn quickly as a youngster. Now I've got to create beautiful sets. Lighting. Where do you start? You need to go to a lighting school to learn how light works.
Yeah.
Especially when it comes to fashion shows. You know, to get the lights perfectly on the models, to get the right photography. All these things. You have to quickly learn, and because you have a competitor that you suddenly find yourself with in New York, and you can see this person is so knowledgeable, and then you quickly have to figure it out and learn what that person knows and why that person knows it, because things work differently in different countries. So I think it's that adaptability that's work for us.
And you also you teach yourself. Are you a type of person who will just dive in and learn by doing?
I would say that's my whole life was based on that, you know.
Really?
And also this thing that I've never been employed. I just had to really look out for myself. Except from being in the military. I was employed when I was in the military, but I had to. But for the rest of it, I was out there on my own. I had to do my own thing. I've never had a boss or earned a salary. I had to do it myself.
Amazing. But now this theater that you have there, I'm intrigued by the idea. And this is absolutely a brilliant idea that you have sofas there.
Sofas, yes. And it also can you see that one in the corner?
Yeah.
And I'm sitting on what I call our African chairs. So people book and say they want to sit on the African chairs. The reason, but there's my Tretyakov chairs. I don't know if you can see them, with the beautiful Karakou skin cover.
Oh, yeah.
It was really because we didn't have money to buy chairs.
Mm.
So we put a notification out. We called it the theater chair drive. So a chair to the theater. And 80% of the chairs have been given to us by people that just really love what we do and wanting to be part of it. And that's why they're all so different. They're different styles and shapes, but that's become part of the character of the theater.
Yeah.
So different. Because there's nothing more boring when you just have straight rows and, you know, like a classroom. This, people feel like this is an extension of their home when they come here.
Yeah.
And they can order a drink at the bar there.
Yeah.
These are the bar. And they come and they sit and they watch all sorts of shows. You're welcome to go onto our website and actually see the Facebook page, Koelkamers, and then our website where people buy tickets. And all the and I strive to have to present a variety of programs. I always like to surprise people with the variety that we offer. Just when you think, oh, it's all live music, then we bring in theater plays, and we have children's theater, and we on Friday we had a book launch of a famous South African writer called Dan Slee. I don't know if you might have heard of him. Mm-hmm. And then also our Arctic exhibits, where we have and that's exciting for me, because we do it because we love it. So we don't have a structure. We'll come across something special or a jewel, and then we will showcase. So people say, oh, okay, I want to come and show my art. It doesn't work that way. You've got to present new work, and you must have something to say. So, for example, if you have a look at the chap that we have at the moment, he takes pictures of marine life, and he goes underwater and takes pictures of seahorses and everything. And he's got a story with every picture that almost reads like a poem. His name is Geo Kluter.
But now in South Africa, because I've been talking to quite a lot of South African artists as well, and it is not so easy in South Africa because many of the theatres closed, and you know, there's only the one opera company, and so you hear also how innovative they are, how they just, you know, create space for themselves to perform and to keep the art alive, their form of art alive. So this is wonderful that you do this, but it's also now in a town that it's not in a big city. So how wide does your audience come from?
I focus on West Coast.
Okay.
So we have a saying, Van Azora tot Eiserfontein, and everything in between. So there's, if you look at the West Coast, I don't know if you're familiar with the West Coast, but I only discovered it because I wanted a holiday house. I first bought in Pringle Bay years ago, then didn't like it because I wasn't on the beach. And I started deliberately going up the West Coast to look for towns that I would really like to have a home or a house. A second home, basically, like a holiday house. Those years I was also based in Cape Town. And I searched, I couldn't find anything. I felt West Coast was very pedestrian and almost mainland by the sea, you know, Pretoria mainland, France and boring and slightly common, if I can say so. We came to Paternoster, and I thought, wow, they've got, you know, that they've got an aesthetics committee, and everything here has to go through them. The town, all the houses and everything is white. There's only one place that's allowed to be red, which is a little restaurant on the beach. And then they check the frames, the sizes of the windows, everything is in this color. So it feels like you've landed up somewhere in Greece, and it's got a South African character. It's really lovely. I don't know. Come out here. It's like,
I'm going to come to your theater, definitely.
It's become like Greaton or all these, you know, these little villages that attract all the artists. Mm-hmm. So at the moment we have Lito Restaurant, one best beach restaurant in Africa. At restaurant awards. We just 2 years ago, the restaurant Wolf Gat, I'm sure you might have heard about that, was voted best restaurant in the world. You can Google it.
Mm.
So we're sitting, and then we have a theater here, and we have all these artists that are settling here. So it really is a special place. So what is happening? People from Cape Town and Durbanville and so on, quite a large Afrikaans community. They come here over the weekends to spend their weekends here. 90% of our houses here are bed and breakfasts. Everyone's a bed and breakfast. So So people, what is happening now, people come to Paternoster because they want to come to theatre. Mm-hmm. And then the town benefits because they have to book in because you can't always drive home. But those are people from Cape Town and the surrounding areas. We have towns like Darling, Langebaan, Veldriff, Vredenburg, Saldanha. Those people have nothing to do. The towns are quite large. This area is exploding. So in the past, they had to drive all the way to Cape Town to go and do something. Now they've got a theatre on their doorstep. So
amazing.
All of that. So for us, it's, people said, oh, this is never going to work. But we have a target audience and I feel now they're eating out of our hands. We just post a new show and then people book and they love the theatre. They love coming here. It's like a whole new, because they're not used to it. A lot of kids that come here have never, ever seen a theatre or a theatre production in their life. It was so heartwarming on Saturday to see all these kids in awe with what's happening on stage.
But this is part of also why I'm doing this project, is to raise awareness to art and to the importance of art also for children's education. Because I think it's like you say, it's how tragic that there are children that has never been in a theater. I've been also thinking about this a lot while I was here, while I'm living here, that there are people, it's so part of their lives to have many theaters around them that they almost cannot imagine that they can live somewhere without a theater, you know? Yeah.
So, between the show productions and this, it's just weird how everything came to pass. But I need to say to all the artists out there, and I can feel it and I'm living it, our restrictions has just been lifted.
Yeah.
It's going to flourish. It's already flourishing. All the artists that I know that's come to the theater, they are fully booked. They're doing shows all over. And everyone is out there now. So what I'm trying to say is we're going into a really, really positive phase for the arts.
Wonderful. And
if people have just the savvy to just, they need to think out of the box.
Yeah.
They can't try and keep things the way it was before. Mm-hmm. The world is a stage. So they need to find ways how they can change their concepts. This is what I've learned, to suit smaller spaces.
Yeah,
I can't put on massive productions here, but I don't want to now, and I don't need to. So even my big bands like Karen Zoid and the Yevils Fantasties or Jesse Clegg and so on, when they come here, they have to think of a smaller space, more intimate. Yeah. Which I love, because I don't like it when it's too commercial, and I don't want to do a show for 300 shouting people, and I can't. There's no space. I want people to have an experience. So, and I believe small theatres are going to flourish, and in smaller towns, it's and there's so I love. One of the things I love is I will never run out of people that I would like to feature on stage. There's so many talented people out there. It's incredible. Every time I'm shocked when I see that, when I see this production and I meet this actor or meet this singer, which I've never heard about, and I see the absolute quality, and I'm thinking, and COVID did ruin everybody. I mean, but all of that, if they're clever and if they just they're willing to work for a little bit less money, because this is the other thing. I can't pay an artist a whack of money to come and perform here. We do a percentage deals, and if they don't want, if they're not interested in percentage deals, it means they're too big for us, basically. Mm-hmm. But then 6 months later, they come back and they say, okay, now they'll do it, because it's becoming a trend or a thing to perform here. So it's like, oh, really? They want it on their CV. You know, it's like the Apollo. Did you perform at the Apollo yet? You know, that kind of thing. And you have to come to the Koelkamers, otherwise you're just not cool enough.
Well, but this intimacy between artist and audience, this is so wonderful. Because, and I think it's so important because I think it's a different way of experiencing also, you know, an artist or a form of art. I just think, I sometimes think also street musicians, you know, when you hear in Vienna, you find it very often that somebody would perform in the street. And I see how people, this closeness of people coming closer to, you know, there's no stage, there's no barrier, and then they connect. I believe they connect better.
Absolutely. And it's what I've picked up in and again on Saturday, it was just too wonderful to watch. And the audience becomes part of the play and that interaction where an audience member can talk to the person acting on stage, and they get asked questions, and it's back and forth, and then you have this repartee, which is what's happening in this theater when we had Karin Zoid, for example. So it's not just about you know, a series of songs that gets played. They talk to the audience, and the audience respond and ask questions and that sort of thing. And I love it. I just love it. And then the theater goers, just, it's so amazing for them that they can see a big artist in such a small, intimate environment. And so I think it's the future.
Yeah, no, definitely. And that connection builds the following, you know, that for the next project that they do, they will have this connection already with the audience.
Yep.
But Jan, this is now, this is so amazing what you do. And I love this idea of this theatre. I'm definitely coming to visit when I come to South Africa.
You're most welcome.
But I want to ask what your wishes are for the future.
I would like, I spoke about it, that we call this, we have a hashtag for our theatre. It's a space for creatives. So part of that is that it covers all creatives. Comedians, to me, are also creatives. And so this is a space where we can come together. And I want to make it an even bigger success of the Koelkamers. And, you know, I'm at the last, if I can put it this way, the last kind of chapter of my life. So I need to start settling. So I'm just happy that COVID has brought me to a point where I feel comfortable within myself, that I don't need to be rushing about trying to achieve, which I've been doing my whole life, just rushing after things, and that I'm comfortable here and I'm happy and I'm content, but I can still do all the wonderful things I like, enjoy doing. So when a client calls and says, I've got a show for you, I've just this year, I was, lucky enough to out of the blue, and I've never been, to go and do a fashion show for Forbes magazine in Dubai, in Abu Dhabi.
Yeah.
If you might have spotted it, if you've, they had the, it was on Women's Day, the 55th, it was called 50 Under 30, where the 50-year-olds, and so we did this amazing show at this big hotel in Abu Dhabi, and then a month later, I got asked to do a fashion show on the Chobe River in Botswana.
Wow.
So all the theater stuff and now going up again, I still have a little bit of that as well. So I'm really blessed and thankful that it's turned out this way.
Yeah, so you have that balance and you can decide what you want to take on.
Exactly. Yeah, in the past I couldn't. I couldn't. I just had to just carry on and just take whatever I could get. Mm-hmm. Now, because of the theater, I can choose, and I am choosing.
Yeah. Well, I think this is what the pandemic also taught us. You know, is that what is important in life. So, but now, Jan, I want to ask you now if you could do a shout out for one of the restaurants or coffee shops in your area.
Oh, there's so many. Am I allowed to do more?
Yeah. I'll put all the links in the description.
Oh, my. Greg, come help. Kathy's Kitchen.
Yeah.
You've got to do Kathy's Kitchen. You've got to do Voorstrand Restaurant. Mm. You've got to do the Seacut.
Yeah.
Lito. There's just too many to mention. We have the best restaurants in Paternoster.
Really?
I did the Voorstrand. Yeah, go and Google them. You can just go to Paternoster restaurants. It's like, and everyone's won a, if it's not a TripAdvisor thing or an award or what. And then we're also sitting with the, and you can please put that link, the Paternoster Hotel is such an institution. It's really? A heritage site. Mm-hmm. And you know, it's got the famous panty bar.
Oh, really?
You heard of a panty bar. Google that. It's been there for years. Yeah, you know, it's come here just to go to the panty bar. So it's, and then what else can I tell you? But what did I not talk about? Yeah, so if this is and Wolfgat, of course, are the restaurant that won the award. Very difficult to get in. You have to book on the web, and it's 3 months. It takes 3 months. They fully booked for 3 months. So
amazing.
Go on the web now to try and book. You probably only get in round about, well, what would it be? August, September, if you're lucky.
Unbelievable.
And then you have this experience. It's like food theater. So
really,
and they only take 18 people at a time. And you can Google them as well. They've got a lot of accolades. And they got another, they won that award. And just last year, they were listed as, I think, top 50 restaurants in the world. They're among that list.
Okay. Now that's look.
We call Paternoster the porch of heaven. I'm going to take you outside just to make you jealous.
That's amazing.
It's important now that I think of it. I'm going out. These are the doors.
Wow. So this the original doors.
Yeah. So I need to, they're quite difficult to open. There we go.
Yeah.
So we close today. So this is my reception. So yeah. I've got all my
beautiful,
all the music that I've used over the years for our show production is on these shelves, because I can't really do much with them, you know, CDs, but they look good. And then over here we've got a wall full of Johannes Kerk oral paintings.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I don't know if you're familiar with him. You know, he's
committed
suicide. He's sort of our we just totally resonate with him. We've got all his poetry and lyrics is written into the paintings. And you can see on the doors, these are all the artists that have already performed here.
That is so lovely that they write their names there.
Yeah. So, and then this is, the door's locked, but look at our view.
Oh, wow. Oh,
so you have the ocean right there, the bay with so this is
that really is beautiful.
You wouldn't want to be anywhere else.
No, definitely. I'm contemplating now moving to Paternoster. It sounds amazing. But Jan, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
Geniet jou dag. Joh, ek hoef eers dit te sê nie, ek kan nie dink in Paternoster.
Dan vat ons weer en dan kom kuier so gou as moontlik en dan sien
ek wil vir jou sê as jy Vienna toe kom, ook moet jy vir my sê. Okay. Ja.
Okay. So romanties.
Okay, Jan.
Hey, bye-bye.
Mooi bly weer, bye.